We have a letter from Ernie McBain to the chairman of the planning board dated January 11th regarding building limits. A letter from Ivan Most, who is not able to be here tonight, commenting on the traffic report with several suggestions, dated 1/15. A notice of a conference which will be held at the Payson Smith Room of the Portland campus of the University of Southern Maine on Wednesday, January 27th, Wednesday, February 3rd, and Wednesday, February 10th on growth management. A letter to the chairman of the planning board from Edward V. Drynan, dated 1/13, regarding the intent of donating a 19-acre portion of land to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. A letter to Michael McGovern from Richard McGoldrick, dated 1/13, regarding the Delano Farms connector. A letter from Michael McGovern to Craig Coffin, dated 1/27, regarding usage of the Cape Elizabeth sewer. A letter to the chairman of the planning board from Jack Roberts, dated November 30th, concerning Brown Homes development. A letter dated December 3rd to Michael McGovern from Peter Rand regarding the Inn by the Sea and the water quality samples which were taken there. A letter to the chairman of the planning board dated 1/19 from Rod and Susan Rouser regarding the Delano Farms traffic situation. And we also, for the record, have a petition with... Excuse me, do you know how many names are on this petition? Are either the Rousers here?
I think Rod Rouser. I think that's a... I'll count them.
Well, that's all right. Just, it looks like a goodly number of names. Regarding the concerns over the Ibis Corporation development on Shore Road. Is there any further correspondence? If not, our first item of business is to consider the Delano Farms application for a preliminary plan review. This is an 8-lot proposed subdivision off Shore Road, and it is coming before us. There are several issues that remain outstanding, which we hope that we can be discussing tonight, such as the length of the cul-de-sac and the possibility of a second entrance, the possibility of a connecting street to Stonegate, the examination of impact of runoff on the site and off and impact on wetlands of the development. We've asked the developer at a previous meeting to return to us with a sketch of several other options, which he has done, and so I would ask if Mr. Taylor, who is here to represent that development, would explain.
Good evening. My name is Bob Taylor, and I'm with Ibis Corporation, the applicant for a proposed 8-lot subdivision off of Shore Road. After much ado about the name, we have come up with another name called Dyer, D-Y-E-R, Pond Road. Some might suggest that we're in dire straits, but I'll let the wags handle that one. The project has been under examination or review or has been presented to the planning board in various forms since this past April. At the immediate past meeting on January 5, we concluded public hearings on the project. And at that time, the board requested that we examine alternatives with regard to the arrangement of the subdivision itself and give some thought to conceptual plans for the balance of the site. This information was submitted to the board last week. The conceptual plans for the balance of the site are just that. They're not intended to be an application for approval of any of the features of the balance of the site, but they are intended to illustrate possible approaches, four possible approaches out of, I'm sure, limitless numbers as to what might happen on the balance of the site. With regard to the project itself, a examination of the arrangement of the lots and the features constraining the development has led us to propose an arrangement with a reduced length of cul-de-sac of 1,800 feet. This also is depicted on the plan that was submitted last week. The developer believes that the general conditions of subdivision approval, which are in Chapter 16, Section 16.1.1, A through K, are met by the proposal. Further, that the conditions of approval for construction in a resource protection district, which are described in Section 19.2.8C, Items 1 through 10, are met. And further, that the standards for approval of wetlands alterations, which are contained on page 19-34, subsection D, of the zoning ordinance have been met. And I think rather than at this time go down through those items point by point by point, which would involve a significant amount of discussion, would ask if the board would rather direct some specific questions to the applicant with regard to those areas where they feel that there has not been compliance with those standards.
I think that we would prefer to use the latter course since we have allotted only an hour for this session, and I think there are still a number of unresolved points, and I personally feel we're still a little fluid on some of these areas.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think that the board has really come to grips with an ultimate solution as to whether they feel it would be preferable to use a cul-de-sac or an 1,800-foot cul-de-sac or to have some sort of connection to the other side of the, or to Mitchell Road. And we have been given a number of materials. I just would like to, before we start asking questions, review some of the materials and some of the salient points in regards to this issue. You noticed in your packet that was sent to you for the January 5th meeting that there was a Buck County Planning Company, a county report in 1980 on the concept and model standards for residential streets, and it concluded that some municipal officials oppose limiting length of cul-de-sacs, but that the benefits accruing to a quiet, safe residential neighborhood heavily overbalance the drawbacks. We also read in that same packet that Don Bissay, the state fire marshal, said that opportunity for blockage is extremely remote. And in our 86 report to the DEP, who have since dropped their limitations on consideration of cul-de-sacs, Al Godfrey, the director of public safety, said in his 32-year career, he knows of no instance in which blockage occurred. On the other side of the coin, I think that we have had testimony from our town manager, who cites several incidences where there has been blockage in the town of Cape Elizabeth. One incident occurred in Cranbrook, in which a fire truck was stuck and that blocked that area. There's also been a blockage on Shore Acres due to construction of the sewer. So there have been incidences of this, and I think that perhaps refutes some of the comments by some of the state officials. We, I think, need to focus tonight. We need to think about what is desirable for the town long term. I think we need to consider safety foremost as our most valuable consideration on this issue. So I would like to ask if any planning board members would like to make comments or ask some questions at this point.
In the past, we've considered cul-de-sac frequently, and we've agreed to extend a cul-de-sac, largely in developments where they were the only approach to develop. Developments where there's no practical alternative. Either you have a cul-de-sac or you just don't have a development. In all honesty, this is not such a case. There is the option of a through road, or possibly a loop. I'm not going to pass on either. So that I think in the case of this particular development, we've got to keep in mind that we do have an option along the plan.
Mr. Boxer, I know that you may have a conflict of interest, but would you feel it would be appropriate to comment from a policy point of view on this matter?
At the appropriate time, I was going to state for the record that someone in my firm does work for Mr. Taylor and or his corporations, and therefore I wouldn't get involved in the discussion of this application or vote on it.
Can you hear Mr. Boxer? Is it on?
I think they can hear me, but it's not on.
A tribute to your booming voice.
I just did what Tinsman told me. I don't have a problem if we're discussing a generic issue like dead-end streets and cul-de-sacs and participating in that discussion. And I'd feel comfortable, again, as long as it wasn't related to a specific application. Doing that, I realize we're in the midst of this application, but to the extent you're soliciting views on streets, and I'm not voting on this application, I'm not uncomfortable being part of that discussion.
Thank you. I do think we also need to consider in looking at this particular matter, this is only a proposal for 8 houses. In the past, we have seen cul-de-sacs go to many, many more houses, even in Cape Elizabeth. This was pre our planning board terms, but it has been done. I think our ordinance says very clearly that we should not go beyond 500 feet without granting a waiver, and that waiver should be based on due to hardship case. So I think we want to think about that too.
Just for the benefit of the board members who didn't go through the agony that you and I and Steve did in revising the ordinance, We discussed this at some great length, and we're faced with a bunch of information as to what we should do about the previous requirement on cul-de-sacs, dead-end streets, and decided to leave in the ordinance the same limitation and not extend it or abolish it because it was more than just a flat-out blockage situation or a traffic situation. I think there was a sense that you didn't necessarily need it from a traffic management standpoint, but that for safety reasons and design of street reasons, there were a lot of reasons why the burden ought to be on the developer to show why he should have a longer street than that, and we ought to stick with what provided a great deal of protection for the cave. Who knows, I've really said much other than that I certainly, from a philosophical standpoint, endorse what we did when we revised the ordinance, which is to leave that requirement in as having some utility.
I know that Ivan Most, and you will see by his notation that he feels that we should not willy-nilly go about waiving standards for cul-de-sacs or beyond 500 feet.
Madam Chairman, in reference to that, I'd like to make reference to the letter from the Cape Elizabeth Fire Department from Donald G. Webster. And under item one, he is concerned about the water main between Shore and Mitchell Roads and states that my concern, quote, is the dead-end hydrant system over 2,000 feet.
Mr. Tinsman?
You saw me reaching.
I'm sorry, go for the button.
I'm not sure, but I think in Stonegate 1 that we required, and I'll defer to Mr. Taylor or to any other board members who remember, I thought we looped the water system between Shore Road and Mitchell Road through that Stonegate 1 and 2.
We provided property rights, but did not actually construct such a connection.
And when I read that from the fire chief, I thought that we had already done that in this development. So I'm not sure how much of a concern that is, even though that has not been implemented yet. On the road question, I'm sorry I missed the last meeting, where I understand there was considerable discussion. And
4 hours.
4 hours on the road issue. I understand a fairly large concern by a number of people, both within the planning board and within the neighborhood. And I guess what you're looking for, Madam Chairman, is some sense of where the planning board feels, or the individual planning board members feel after reading all of the discussion, all of the letters that have come from residents, the petition that we now have, a couple of pieces of correspondence between the town manager and a couple of residents of the area. And I find it curious that the planning board sits here after several meetings where we've talked to the developer of the proposed development about a cross-connect road for safety purposes and a number of other reasons. Reluctantly, I think the developer has shown how that connection might exist, but I've always had the impression that the developer really didn't want to put that cross-connection in. We have a number of residents both in the Stonegate development, which is new, along Mitchell Road, which is historically developed, and on the Shore Road side, who are opposed to a cross-connect. And I think as a land use that we could, as a town, anticipate that residents would not want cross-connects where dead-end roads exist or where additional traffic might be put on to existing roads. Understanding that and seeing some of the correspondence that's transpired, not having participated in the discussion that you had at the last meeting, maybe I need some more background. I thought the planning board members, up to the last meeting at least, felt that the possibility of a cross-connect was important from a future standpoint of the community, that We weren't necessarily at this point, and maybe this is my own thought, we weren't necessarily looking for a two-lane highway going through from Mitchell Road to Shore Road, but that we wanted to see enough space reserved and enough of a right-of-way to allow for emergency access of vehicles if they were ever needed, or for the future of the community, the year 2050 or whenever might be desired, the opportunity for a road. There may be a desire by the citizens in that area at that point to have some cross connect, and I think one of the purposes of our planning in 1988 is that we don't shortchange or we don't preclude opportunities existing in the future of the community. And there have been a number of situations in the town where we have just outright, for one reason or another, not considered the future of the community and not provided for means of egress through roads in the town. Whether that's good or bad, I won't comment. But I think that it's important that we look at the future of the town and that we not preclude the opportunity for things to happen. It doesn't mean that there will ever be a two-lane highway, but maybe we should allow that to the future community to decide rather than today's community and forestall that opportunity. As one planning board member, I would be in favor of having a right-of-way existing that connects Stonegate 1 and Shore Road. I would be in favor of not necessarily having that as a defined road in 1988, 89, 1990, or 1995, but that the opportunity exists there for the future of the community to have that.
Thank you. Mr. Tinsman, I think you summarized very well what varying opinions have been pooled into the planning board's trying to make a decision on this. There's no question but what there are a lot of neighbors who are very concerned about the possibility that a connector road as a super highway type would go between Shore Road and Mitchell Road, and I don't think that ever was the intention of the developer or the thought behind the planning board or the town. But I think you bring up an excellent point in that we do have to think along down the road, so to speak. It is important from a safety point of view, perhaps, to have another access. But for 8 homes, I personally do not feel that this is a critical issue to have a connector. I do, however, believe that it we don't want to preclude our options for sometime eventually having some way to get out through to Mitchell Road. And I also feel that doesn't have to be written, etched in a plan right now, but if a town right-of-way could be dedicated by the developer so that at some future point, if the town wanted to make use of that, they could. And I guess I feel that I would like to see that kind of a solution to this situation. Any other? Yes.
I agree with what you've said, Madam Chairman. However, I don't feel that studying the viability of connector roads is all there is to good planning. And I will reiterate what I said from the very beginning, that we have failed to look at this as an entire parcel and plan accordingly for an entire parcel. It is owned by one person. If you really think about the way this the preliminary plan has been presented to us, it appears that we are dealing with two separate parcels. This is one parcel, and I do not feel that on fragile pieces of land we can afford to develop this way. I think that we have to consider all things for the future, and on fragile pieces of land where resource protection area exists and ponds and streams, we can't just take one small piece and say, let's plow through all that to achieve a connector road and not look at the parcel as a whole.
Marin, you have brought this point up before, and I think it is good.
Many times.
The DEP also feels we should consider this as one entity. I guess my view is, from having read both traffic reports and all the letters, that there is no way that a connector road could be straight through that land due to many wetlands and rock surfaces and so forth. My conclusion is that even with a crooked road, this is not ever going to be used, could never be used as a diverter for traffic, as a major diverter for traffic. And so I guess I lean a little bit more towards, for that reason, going with at least a right-of-way so that we don't close our doors to the future. I think maybe what we need to do is to kind of poll you all and see how you feel about this. I don't think we are going to resolve this tonight. I'd like to see the developer work out with the town the perfect compromise, and I think we may have to come to a compromise, but I'd like to get the sense of the board before we give that direction. So, Mrs. Guthrie, how would you feel?
Well, I'd have to try to say this and not take up an hour. I have many concerns about safety in this community, but to date, I have seen no facts presented that would indicate that we need a connector road at this particular place. I think what bothers me more is the proposed access road and no other alternatives presented to it. The proposed access road bisects Pond 1, I think you call it on the map.
Pond 3.
Pond 3. Well, Pond 3 has flooded in the past. And according to a letter dated August 27, 1987, from E.C. Jordan Company, the engineers, I won't read the whole letter, they indicate that with or without this development, that particular pond is going to overtop Shore Road. It has in the past, and the road collapsed. Okay? Then last week, it was January 5th, I asked the town engineer about this very same thing. And he stated that even a new culvert, an enlarged culvert under Shore Road, would not mitigate the flood waters. So it's going to flood. Now, by placing a road right on top of this pond, I think it's very safe to assume that that road too will flood. If this is a cul-de-sac, then during the flooding process, 8 homes might not be able to be reached in the event of an emergency. If this becomes a connector road and it's flooded, well, I mean, we've spent an awful lot of money on a connector road that is just going to be disconnected. So I would like to see an alternative. There have been other accesses mentioned, and they have not been explored, and I ask that if you would please explore them the last time, and I haven't seen any exploration to date of other accesses. So that is really my concern. It goes beyond connector roads, it goes beyond cul-de-sacs, and we can discuss them all night It's where that particular access road has been placed.
Thank you, Mrs. Guthrie. Mr. Orr, do you have a sense as to how you would feel about having a right-of-way or...
I would want to see that the road layout in this area so that it didn't, at minimum, it didn't permanently bar a connector road. And again, I'm looking forward to the idea that we don't shut this thing off forever.
I guess I really haven't changed my mind that I do feel that we should allow for a right-of-way at least. And I know that there are other issues which we need to get into, which Marion has alluded to, such as runoff and drainage and flooding, wetlands. But as far as the length of the cul-de-sac being 1,800 feet and with a right-of-way dedicated to the town, and that right-of-way listed in all of the deeds, then I would feel that that would be a good investment in the future. Mr. Pendleton.
My turn. I guess I mentioned before how I felt, and I haven't changed. Lest the Marion's comments go unanswered, I think all of us have concerns about the development as a whole that we have to address. There are many, many other questions that relate to the development that we're going to have to get into and make a decision on as we look at the preliminary plan. Whether we approve or disapprove the plan is something that I don't think we're talking about right now. I think we're only talking, I understand the question, I think, solely one of connector road. I've stated my position. I don't think we have to build it now. I think that a right-of-way for the future of the town is important. I'm not as concerned about the length of the cul-de-sac with such a low density on it. We may be a better community if we had such a low density throughout the town with longer dead-end roads. Again, though, that I think we would be very short-sighted as a town to allow roads that in the future of the town might require some connection, not to at least have that opportunity. Once a road goes in, once land becomes owned, it's impossible to get a right-of-way for any purposes, such as a road going through.
Thank you, Mr. Tinsman. Since there seem to be three, if I gather correctly, people who feel that we should be working perhaps towards that cul-de-sac and a right-of-way, maybe, Mr. Taylor, you could meet with the town fathers, not the town fathers, but the sons and planners, and try to come up with a phrasing that I would expect the planning board would be able to accept. Are there any comments you want to make at this point?
I have just a few questions with regard to some of the comments that have been made, and I just wanted to reiterate some of the submittals and the information that's been presented in very quick summary form, and ask if there are specific further additional pieces of data that are required. One of the issues I am concerned about is the question of overflowing a shore road. The overflowing of shore road for the design storm that is required by the ordinance is a fact of life today, and the project as proposed would reduce the amount of overflowing of shore road, so that the project's effect with regard to the overflow connection, the overflowing of the road, is only beneficial. Secondly, with regard to flooding of the road, the overflow occurs in this area here, which is a couple of hundred feet southerly of the proposed road entrance. That is the local low point in Shore Road, and that is detailed on all the plans that have been submitted to you. The elevations of the connector road and of Shore Road at the point of connection are adequate to be above the 25-year 24-hour storm that is the required design storm. Finally, prior collapse of the road is a difficult concept to deal with in the sense that what we had, to my understanding, was not a collapse of the road, but a failure of a very ancient and rusted corrugated metal pipe culvert, which was brought about more by age than any specific flood condition. Further, I have a question as to what the sense of the board is with regard to a right-of-way. The plan that's in front of the board today provides access through the project to the remaining land of the applicant that would provide for any future connection in the event that some future development required that. Not only is it provided through in the direction of Mitchell Road, but it is also provided through in the direction of the property immediately to the south, which currently belongs to the Robinson family. And I would ask those members who expressed concern for a through roadway or through right-of-way whether what they see on the plan today, which is something that would not preclude future development of the road, but is not a granted right-of-way all the way through to Mitchell Road, is what they are asking for, or are you asking for a granted right-of-way all the way through to Mitchell Road? If I may, just for clarification purposes, I note that the cul-de-sac is in this area here, the turnaround, the end of the road construction, but that a right-of-way 50 feet in width has been provided to the end of the project, which would be a potential future connector. And secondly, a right-of-way 50 feet in width has been provided heading to the south to make connection to any future development in this area. And in that regard, I believe the plan does not preclude future through road construction. It is our belief that through road construction should not take place. We don't feel that any strong need has been demonstrated for it, and we are not proposing through road construction. We are, however, proposing an arrangement that does not close out any options. And I didn't hear sufficient definition in some of the comments to judge whether what we have here is the desire of the board or whether the board wants something more.
I would just offer that I think probably what you have there is sufficient, but I would like to see this inserted in the deed of all the lot owners. Mm-hmm. So that is a clear understanding, and this is not at all to encourage a connector, but just to make them aware that there may be.
Madam Chairman, I agree. We have before a proposal, though it's contiguous ownership, and we've talked in a couple of meetings about the prospects of development in the remaining land that Ibis owns adjacent to the approved Stonegate subdivision. We don't have a proposal for that other piece of land, although a concept plan has been developed and we've taken a look at it. Ibis could turn around and sell it tomorrow. It would be somebody else's chunk of land that they would have to come back to the town for approval for any subdivision. And I think that by taking a right-of-way directly through to Mitchell Road would preclude other options that we might have at that time for talking about any number of arrangements for subdivision in that area. So I think the right-of-way extending to the property line, to the project line, which has been indicated by Ibis, whether or not we approve it as a piece of a larger puzzle, I don't know whether we're going to do that yet. I would agree with you, though, that taking it to the project line would be appropriate. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Any other comments on that matter?
I would take that.
Yeah. You would.
A further question that has been raised has been the question of possible alternative locations for the entrance on Shore Road. And I will point out that the applicant has submitted engineering studies for two possible locations, has submitted comparative data on wetlands impacts for the two possible alignments. And the two possible alignments were chosen with some care. The first, which was originally proposed, was immediately opposite the entrance number one to Delano Park. And it represents, in the opinion of the traffic engineer, an adequate entrance. The second that was chosen, and is the applicant's current proposal, is to the south of that. And also, in the opinion of the applicant's engineer and in the opinion of the town's engineer, is an adequate location. The reason that the applicant prefers the current proposed location is that by construction of the road embankment in that location, it is possible to make greater effective use of Pond 3 as a retention basin to further reduce the effects of downstream flooding and overtopping. This we discussed at the last meeting. As far as locations in between, there are a certain range of locations immediately to the north of that currently proposed, which would essentially involve channelizing or placing in a conduit a substantial length of the creek bed, and we felt that the stream alteration required to do that was an impact that was not warranted, given that the proposal is at an area of relatively slight wetlands impact and along the alignment of the existing entrance and indeed opposite the gap in the guardrail that was left during the recent during the most recent construction of Shore Road. There is possible, between entrance one and the stream bed, additional almost an infinite number, if you will, you can move over an eighth of an inch at a time, road locations. Are with regard to entrance one, there's a principle in traffic engineering that says you attempt to reduce conflict points. Okay. Placing an entrance opposite entrance one of Delano Park now creates, if you will, a four-way conflict at that intersection, whereas placing the intersection at the proposed location reduces that to a three-way conflict, if you will, and also provides sufficient separation from entrance number one so that there is time for drivers to adapt to the fact that they are now on Shore Road and to recognize any possible hazards entrance number one if they come out of Delano, out of Dyer Pond Road and turn north. So the applicant has studied and submitted data on impacts and on feasibility from a traffic point of view for two locations and has chosen to study no additional locations because of the reasons I've just outlined.
Thank you, Mr. Taylor. Just to add a little addendum, I think Mr. Butler has something he'd like to say about the...
Marion, that's all right. I would like to reference, probably for the third time, the August 24th letter written by the Chief of Police of Cape Elizabeth. And I thought it was a very intelligent letter, proposed an entrance to this development which would be 50 feet south of entrance one, which was your first proposal. And he listed some very good reasons why this would be better. And I guess for some reason I forget what reason you stated you did not look into this.
Perhaps if I could have the benefit of those particular points, I could deal
sure.
with them in the context of the
All
alternatives.
Right. As I said, to paraphrase, he suggests a road 50 feet south of the proposed location, which was entrance one, your first proposal. And the chief says, this design would provide a little more reaction time and distance from the egress onto Shore Road. Additionally, a vehicle leaving the more southerly entrance, turning northbound, would encounter a more shallow takeoff grade, allowing for a better approach during winter weather conditions, which were discussed at length at the public hearing. The more southerly entrance would not, it appears to me, and this was very important to me, encroach unduly on the obvious wetlands visible at the site. Finally, it is important to note that, and he goes on to mention, serious pruning of the entire site with continual monitoring.
I'm sorry, I didn't catch that last.
Continuous pruning of the entire site with constant monitoring.
Okay. If I may, point by point, by placing the entrance even farther south and farther away from entrance 1 to Delano Park, I believe that we make the reaction time even greater, so that I think that we have an improved alternative over that suggested by the chief. Secondly, the grade is lesser at the proposed location than at a location 50 feet south of Delano Park, so that I think that that argues more, you know, if you will, pushes us towards the applicant's proposed location. With regard to not encroaching unduly on wetlands, an examination of the extent of the wetlands in this area would say that there is perhaps some small savings in the amount of wetland encroached upon. However, we believe that the encroachments that are proposed are appropriate. Further, continuous pruning and monitoring would be provided for, in that sufficient property rights would be granted the town in the maintenance of the proposed Dyer Pond Road, and if it were necessary to provide additional right-of-way width along Shore Road, we would be pleased to do this.
Ask you a question about the entrance proposed by the chief of police.
Mm-hmm.
From the point of view of wetlands, if you did explore this particular entrance, would you have to bisect pines? And would you have to alter any streams, as you apparently have to do with your currently proposed entrance?
The answer to both questions is yes, because at the elevations that Pond 3 reaches under design storm conditions, it extends substantially farther than what is shown as wetland on the plan. And the reason is that the design conditions are stringent enough that they don't occur very frequently, so that you don't get wetlands effects from those design conditions. And so we would be in the wetlands, and we would be bisecting the area that is Pond 3 under the design condition. However, we are bisecting it in such a location that it does not give us the benefit that we have achieved by the applicant's proposed location of preserving a large part of Pond 3 until relatively late in the storm as a detention basin. So I would have to say, and of course there is stream alteration because you must cross the stream. So I would say that the impact of the stream alterations are, in my opinion, roughly equal. There is slightly less wetlands alteration required for the chief's proposed location. And finally, the chief's proposed location would not have the stormwater control benefits that the applicant's proposed location would have. So I believe that while we have not made formal study of the chief's proposed location, those facts, as I have recited them, lead me to believe that the applicant's proposed location is the correct one.
Thank you.
We'd like to just revert to the consideration of the stipulations for the connector, and I think Mr. Butler has a comment. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Just to follow up, I think as Mr. Tinsman pointed out, there is the possibility that phase two of the site could be sold by Mr. Taylor and company. Therefore, I'd just like to recommend that the deed restrictions that were mentioned for the eight lots also be considered, and Mr. Taylor worked with the town attorney to make sure that similar condition is placed on the deed for the remaining land, so that if it is indeed conveyed, that the town still has the right to pursue the right-of-way options in the future.
If I may. I believe that that's inappropriate, and I believe that it's inappropriate for the following reasons. One, such a vague encumbrance as you describe has very little practical value to the town. The town has, at least members of the town staff have indicated to me, that the town would at no time at its own expense construct such a through road. And finally, in the event that the balance of the site came before the planning board for some future approval, the board could at that time deal with the issue of providing for a through connector on the balance of the site. Finally, if the site balance of the site remains undeveloped and the need for a through connector for public safety is so great that the town wishes to construct for public safety purposes a connector, they have the power of eminent domain and should exercise that. And that, I believe, is the proper approach to providing access across the balance of the parcel.
In response, speaking for the town, I think that the town would prefer not to have to exercise eminent domain, number one. And number two, would want to make sure that in this development process that it had sufficient rights retained by it, so that indeed if in the future wanted to pursue some of the options in terms of a connector road or at least emergency vehicle access road between Shore Road and Mitchell Road, that it was done in a way that would be most advantageous to the town, so it wouldn't have to go to court to achieve those means. So I would suggest through some means or another that the developer and the town attorney perhaps work out some arrangement that would legally satisfy the town and the applicant.
There's an existing Woods Road on the site that connects Mitchell Road to Shore Road. And I would have no problem granting, I think that what would be appropriate here is some clarification of the town's powers with regard to use of existing wood roads by public safety vehicles and the possibilities that the town has in front of it to develop a road if it ever chose to. I personally believe that the possibilities are so remote as to be not worth considering, that the town would actually spend the money to build a road across the developer's land and then allow the developer to come along and divide it into house lots after the town has built it. That just has not been the history of the town of Cape Elizabeth. So I don't feel that the encumbrance that you suggest on the balance of the property serves any practical purpose, because I don't feel it would ever be utilized. Certainly in terms of a fire engine getting on the existing Woods Road that runs from Mitchell Road to the project, we would have no objection and would be happy to write the town a letter that we have no objection to such use.
Madam Chairman, this is an excellent example of what happens when there is piecemeal planning. And I would just like to return to what I said before. This sets a terrible precedence, I think, for any developer on a fragile piece of land dotted by resource protection and ponds and streams to come forward with a small little plan having to do with a part of that, when to be well developed and creatively developed, we should be looking at the whole thing. And I mean, I see so many problems arising from this. We have people here sitting from Stonegate who were never told about the possibility of a connector road, because obviously we didn't have their names as abutters, because the second part of the project was never planned. Now, I am really going to insist that from now on, we never, ever get ourselves boxed in, excuse me, Mr. Boxer, boxed in this way on a small piece, because it constitutes the worst possible planning.
If I may. I think we have just another matter that we were pursuing, and Mr. Butler has yet something else to say.
I'll leave it at this. I think we could go back and forth perhaps all night, Bob.
Yeah.
I think the town, I've heard some expressions of concern about the reservation of future options if the town wish to pursue them, to have some sort of road through to Mitchell Road. And I still think that the town needs to have some sort of ability to, at a later point, if it's dealing with another owner of the property in Phase 2, to have some leverage so that the concerns are raised today can be brought out. It doesn't say that the right-of-way, the roadway, will be constructed, but at least gives the town the right to pursue those rights up front if it wishes to do so. And I think if you don't address that, the town loses quite a bit in terms of future leverage.
I guess I would like to add that we would feel more adequately insured if you could pursue this with the town attorney. Taylor, even though perhaps you foresee no practical outcome. Mr. Tennyson, did you vote?
Yes, I did. I guess I agree with Steve that it's awfully important not to, again, shortchange ourselves by having that as an option. So we've got to protect ourselves in that regard. If indeed having the right-of-way through there is important, and since we're dealing with a single landowner, we should be insisting on at least having that as an option. I also agree with Marion's comments about piecemeal development. That's why I think at the beginning that Marion and other members of the planning board insisted that we see a conceptual layout of what Ibis Corporation wanted to do in that land and how it related to the Stonegate development. And though we see a conceptual development, that doesn't mean that it's going to be like that, and that doesn't even mean that Ibis is going to develop it, and I think we always have to keep that in mind. Absolutely right, Marion, that piecemeal development is probably the worst way to approach a large tract of land. On the other hand, our options are, under our ordinances, as we review proposals, to deny the application based on the fact that it's not a comprehensive approach to land use and development. We have before us a proposal from a person who owns an amount of land, a corporation who owns an amount of land. We have to either approve it or disapprove it under the terms of our ordinance, and that certainly is an option.
I did see a hand. This isn't a public hearing. If you could make a brief comment, that would be appreciated.
Thank you very much. My name is Victor Golden.
Would you just come up to the microphone, please? We've got all the media going here tonight. So.
I appreciate your indulgence.
Thank you very much. The notice to the public hearing was sent to my former address on Tides Edge Road. That's why I wasn't here on January 5th. I received that letter on January 10th. You had a discussion earlier about planning, and I wanted to point out a couple of things. We've bought two lots at Stonegate and have built a house there, which is a major investment for us. The primary reason we did that was because when we reviewed the plan, we looked at a U-shaped road that entered Mitchell Road and ended on Mitchell Road. And one of the reasons, probably the major reason for us leaving the Shore Road area, was the traffic. We have two young children. We wanted a place where the kids could go out and get on their bicycle and ride and not worry about cars speeding by.
When that plan was approved, which must have been a couple of years ago, I guess, if it was by this board, the subdivision was approved and a plot plan was set out. You're now proposing to connect a through road to, apparently, to Stonegate Road. The discussion tonight has been to Mitchell Road, and I'm not sure whether you're talking, the plan that I saw showed it tied into Stonegate Road. I believe that there would be, I think, a lot of legal problems if that were approved. Certainly, we would have to exercise any rights we had, because I sincerely feel that the safety of our children and the value of our investment in that property and that of all of our neighbors who have already purchased lots there, and I think there are 19 property owners, would be severely jeopardized. We now use, when we go back to our old house to check the boiler, Oakhurst Road. And that is a thoroughfare. And I don't want to see that happen on a place that I've just bought a lot. And I think I can see that you have a real serious problem here. But I think that if you follow through with the concept of proper planning, as outlined in any planning program I've ever seen, that you would insist, as does the Department of Environmental Protection, that this development come under comprehensive zoning, that you understand that, in fact, you most likely will be dealing with another developer. This project is now on the market in its undeveloped state, and that the project not be approved tonight until those facts are examined completely. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. McGovern. We did receive your letter, and so we have that under consideration, but we appreciate your comments in addition. I guess new light has been shed a little bit. Mr. Taylor, do you want to make any comment about the land being for sale or your option or whatever?
Quite frankly, felt that an eight-lot subdivision would not engender the amount of opposition or the difficulties in licensing that it has. And we feel that in the face of an uncertain economic climate, we have to keep our options open. So we have indeed offered the project for sale. We are also searching for joint venture partners, and we are continuing with the licensing, all of which so we have the maximum possible options available to us. Well, there is currently no active discussions with any potential buyer. There are some discussions with potential joint venture partners.
Thank you.
Proceeding.
We do still have a number of other issues that we have not yet addressed. I hesitate to go a great deal further, but I know that there are questions about runoff and stormwater control that need to be addressed. Does anyone wish to ask any questions on either of those particular points? Would the Conservation Commission like to make any comments or address either of those points?
Madam
yes.
Chairman, if no one else has a question, I have a small one. In reference to the letter to you, Mr. Taylor, from the Department of Environmental Protection, dated December 29th, just one small question on that. On page 2, the gentleman who was writing the letter, a Donald B. Kale, says that in addition to the so-called site permit, I have determined that a stream alteration permit, and he lists, you know, some letters and numbers, will be needed prior to the commencement of roadbed expansion and filling at that stretch on your plans marked with a white arrow, et cetera, et cetera. And then he goes on to mention an Oakhurst Brook and his concern for proposed fill being washed into that brook. Does he mean Oakhurst Brook or Cranbrook? And could you just point that out as a...
He means this area here.
Yeah.
Okay, which we have called Cranbrook Brook, but which appears with those names nowhere but our documents, so confusion can be created.
Is he aware that what he refers to as Oakhurst Brook is really the Cranbrook that runs under Shore Road and down through Delano Park to the Atlantic Ocean? Yes.
From my discussions with him, he is.
Okay. Thank you.
One thing that I think we might like to see before we progress into another session, and I'm sure that the board at least would feel that we would like to seek your approval for an extension of a preliminary plan review as well as an extension of a wetlands hearing permit due to some of these rather fluid issues that are still outstanding. Is the matter of site distance, you can gain 450 feet on either side, but and you would have to do a fair amount of clearing to do that. I think it would be very helpful to the board to see how much clearing would be required to do that. If you could stake that out and we could look at that, I think it might be useful for our...
On the site visit, we staked out those distances from both the proposed entrance locations, and the board had an opportunity to examine it at that time. Does the board need this a second time?
What I'm asking for is the depth in for clearing to gain that, which we did not have when we were not. We did have the site distance, I agree.
It's just a straight line between where you were standing and where the stake was.
I think we'd like to see how much mm-hmm. would have to be cleared to in order to achieve that.
Were you asking for public comment before?
I would like to say once again that this isn't a public hearing, but if you can make your comment very brief, fine.
Question.
Oh, question. All right.
Madam Chairman and the Planning Board, I'm John Boomer from Delano Park. I'm obviously not privy to all of the maps and charts that you've gotten. Has there been a map or plan of what this development would look like during the height of a 25-year storm, which we just had mention of back 10 minutes ago or so? That it would create more water standing, and I ask you to consider that in light of when someone buys a house lot in a development, they usually expect it to be something that's high or dry or usable. But I'm wondering what it would look like if this was redrawn. Not with just the wetlands as they are now, but during those major storms, and see if it turns into they're really buying little tiny high spots in a much broader pond or lake area.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Boomer. I don't believe we have such a map. We do have rather extensive engineering studies which have calculated the storm drainage. But there are several more questions that relate to this, and we had hoped that Mr. Hunter might have been able to have commented on Mr. Mitchell's letter, which was so excellent in regards to the peak flow and 24-hour storms, but we do not have that. I think we need that before we progress. And I do think we need a much clearer explanation of impacts downstream as well as on site. We are going to are engaging a wetlands specialist to study those impacts, so that we can have a very thorough study done by our own hired person. Mr. Tinsman, did you have some other...
Yeah, I just think that was an excellent request, that we are to look at the 25-year, 24-hour. We see a lot of graphs and charts and numbers, and knowing the people who prepared those, I believe what they're saying. graphically and visually, it would be good to have that kind of representation so that we can see where the limits of flooding are going to be. Marion's questions earlier about overtopping roads needs and begs for that kind of visual piece of evidence.
And as I understand it from the design of the storm drainage at Shore Road, the developer has said he will be able to mitigate the peak flow, but it will actually lengthen out. Is that correct, Mr. Taylor?
That is correct.
So that although the peak flow is going to be lengthened out, it will go for a longer period of time. I think we need to know a little bit more about that impact, too.
Well,
so if you could put on a map some of these answers to some of these questions, I think that would be satisfying.
The information is all in the record with regard to that. The timing of the water levels at the various elevations is given in detail in a, you know, appended to the report. The elevations of the peak water level are, you know, are given in the report. It is a matter only of those people who wish to examine the record looking and seeing that the peak elevation in Pond 3 is 47.4 and chasing the 47-foot contour. That's the 48-foot contour that I'm chasing now. In terms of the information being in the record, the information is in the record. In terms of Mr. Hunter and his and your question with regard to Mr. Mitchell's letter, I believe Mr. Hunter stated quite firmly that the storm water analysis as performed by E.C. Jordan was adequate at the public hearing. Further, we provided confirmation of the flood used. And indeed, this is the flood used in all the submittals here in Cape Elizabeth because it is what the ordinance requires. Now, I have no difficulty with providing information to the board, but I have a great deal of difficulty with providing it 3, 4, and 5 times.
Madam Chairman, I sense that the applicant desires to have approval this evening. I'm not sure, but it seems to me that that's the case. And having missed the public hearing on the wetlands ordinance, could you bring me up to speed on where we are in the process and whether this board in fact can, or whether all of the mandated requirements are, all the information is submitted, all the hearings have been held, and what is expected of this board this evening?
As I stated earlier, I do not feel that we have enough, that we do need more information, and I feel, and I don't know how the other planning board members feel, but I speak personally for myself, that we need to hear further from Bob Hunter, we need to hear from our own wetland specialist that we are hiring as to the environmental impacts. I do not think that we can give any approval tonight for preliminary plan approval, nor do I feel that we can give a wetlands alteration permit. So the option would be, if the developer really wishes us to consider that tonight, I think it might be that we would have to deny the application.
Have we hired a wetlands expert yet, or are we in the process of interviewing?
The town's in the process of soliciting proposals. It's received two. It will receive another one in the middle of this week, and I would anticipate that we'd be hiring somebody, we'd be selecting a wetland specialist by the end of this week. I would say Friday of this week, Monday of next week. The idea is not to prolong this any more than necessary, but to get a consultant in that can come in, do the work, and report to the board in person as well as with a written report at the February meeting, so that hopefully that issue will be resolved once and for all from the town's perspective, and the applicant will get a clear answer in terms of what, you know, any issues that are remaining, you know, exactly what those might be.
What is the timing, I'm sorry, of that report?
The timing would be
by
the February meeting, and a presentation, if desired by the board, at that meeting.
I just have a generic question about hiring of consultants. I take it this is a one-shot engagement for this particular application. at some point in time, I think we ought to talk about if they're hired, how the field is narrowed, and maybe you've done this already, the various qualifications and what role the planning board has in both hiring the consultant and giving them their assignment, which may relate to different things that are on the minds of different planning board members. I don't know whether that's been done here, and I just toss that out as something subsequent applications. Seems to me to make some sense, not to just go ahead and do it and have them give a report back.
We've been working primarily through Alice, as viewing her as the spokesperson for the planning board. I think it's an excellent idea, Dan. In the future, in terms of getting your input, you know, technically it's the town manager that would procure the services, so we've been trying to expedite things so that we could call two or three, four different firms, get some proposals, evaluate them from a number of different perspectives, primary of which is, you know, what can they do in terms of actually telling the town what it needs to know.
However, and if I can just refer back to the traffic report that we asked for, we did gain the input of the full planning board. We were trying to perhaps move along a little faster so that we, although we did discuss this topic, which I think you were not.
Madam Chairman, just for the record, who is paying for this particular report?
Not the developer. The town would be paying for this.
Excellent. Thank you.
I think just to move this along, one more question. Have you selected a new name, and do you want to put that officially forward?
It's on the plan.
It is on the plan.
And I indicated it's Dyer Pond Road in my preparatory remarks. May I make a further comment in general? I think, as I have indicated to the staff in prior discussions, we have no problem with granting the town an extension of time under the terms of its own ordinance to allow the decision-making process to carry forward in the February meeting. That's not at issue here. I am distressed, however, that in an application which has been pending before the board since August 9th, it is now January, and we are selecting further additional consultants, particularly where the board has determined that it has adequate information to make a decision in its earlier processes. And I think that there is a certain fairness issue here that has to come into play. The board has had a complete application for a substantial time now, and I quite frankly don't think it's appropriate that the board intimate that the decision is pending on an expert that needs to be hired now when the information has been in the record for a long time. That's perhaps just my frustration, but we all know that frustration doesn't do us much good.
I sympathize with your frustration, Mr. Taylor. However, we are dealing with a rather extraordinary piece of property here, in that it has a great many wetlands on it. We are involved with the Army Corps of Engineers, the EPA. There are a lot of officials that we need to be in touch with. I don't think either one of us, either the developer or the planning board, realized how many questions we would have about this. I think there are a lot of safety factors still unresolved, and a lot of issues still sort of fluid. So I hope you'll bear with us while we try to do a good job of doing our planning.
Well, it seems to me that this process was delayed one prior time, when after the applicant's submittal of the traffic data required by the ordinance, which the board had determined was sufficient to make a decision, the board asked for an extension of the time period for setting a public hearing in order to procure a traffic expert. I don't believe that the board has lived up to their end of the process in this regard. And as I have said before, we have no objection to extending the decision period to the February meeting, but we are extremely disappointed that the board is at this late date finding one more expert, and we wonder what will happen at the February meeting. Further, with regard to the issues of other regulatory agencies, there is a mechanism within the ordinance to deal with this, and that is that the planning board gives preliminary approval or denies preliminary approval as it sees fit, based on the information required by the ordinance and supplied by the developer. There is a period between preliminary and final approval where approvals and permits required by other regulatory agencies are sought and hopefully obtained by the developer. And we feel that to abandon this time-honored and legislated process is not appropriate either. So you have my opinion, and you may do with it as you wish.
Thank you.
Madam Chairman, can we comment on it for a moment?
Yes, you certainly may.
Thank you.
Be my guest.
I guess I can say this not having been at the meeting. I presume that I can, having discussed the meeting with the chairman after that meeting, that during the hearing on wetlands, there were a number of issues that were raised that caused sufficient concerns on the part of the planning board to suggest that the planning board, that it required an independent review of those wetland issues to satisfy the board members that what it had was information that it could act on. Now, I would hope that that would be perceived as a speeding of the process rather than asking the applicant to submit additional data, whatever that might have been. But I would hope that the planning board does not pull back from a position of ever having a question on the technical capability of information. It may have been complete, but that doesn't mean that it's acceptable. And I would think that the planning board, if it found information that just somehow needed a little bit of clarification and needed some expertise on its side paid by the town, that it would feel free to get that information. It would expedite that process. I think we held a public hearing at the beginning of this month out of sequence, out of the normal board process, in order to expedite the process. I would suggest that since that meeting on January 5th, that the board has moved to take proposals and to get someone on board that could comment on a particular application and the particular issues in the application. And so I'm not sure that I feel that the board is remiss in any way in its duties. I think, in fact, it would be remiss in its duties if it did otherwise.
Thank you, Mr. Tinsman. You said all the words that I would like to have. Very well. I guess we're at a point where we would like to ask you if you'd be willing to go to the February meeting for a preliminary plan continuance and for the wetlands alteration permitting process. Well,
I have stated before that this, you know, is acceptable to the applicant. I would point out, however, that the hiring of a wetlands expert was mentioned prior to the January 5 public meeting to me by the staff, so it is not a creature of the January 5 public hearing. And secondly, I did not hear substantial questions of Dr. Mishner at the public hearing that would indicate what issues the board is concerned with, because we feel on the issue of fairness, the applicant should have an opportunity to respond to those concerns directly.
Madam Chairman, I move we table the application to the February meeting, pending a review by our environmental consultant of the proposal.
Is there a second?
Second.
It has been moved and seconded that we table this application until the February regular meeting of the planning board, and thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Our next item of business is Elizabeth Farms.
Don't be like me and not do that.
Elizabeth Farms is coming before us for an amendment to an approved plan, and you will find that we will be referring to page 12 of our new ordinance under section 16-2-5, so that you will have a reference as to where we are. Mr. Weinschenk, are you presenting tonight?
Good evening. What we're here to discuss this evening is the request to subdivide the approved 43 about acre lot that is basically the meadow and the hill to the north of the meadow at Elizabeth Farms from the previously approved 16 unit condominium lot to 6 2-plus acre lots to be used for single family dwellings, leaving 1 25-plus acre parcel that should be owned in common by all then 36 individual single family lots.
Do you want to add anything more at this point, or have your...
I think that we've had a couple of issues come up, and we ought to just let Tom discuss, which I think is a major one, which is the road, and then maybe we get back onto the effect onto the rest of the development.
Thank you. My name is Tom Greer from Pinkham and Greer. We're the engineers on the project. What we have shown here with this map is this being the approved road system here. In red are the four condominium buildings which house the 16 structures. Give you an idea of what is existing as approved. The green structures are approximate locations of where single family dwellings would be placed. There is obviously one missing. It happens to be far right on top of this condominium unit, so there was a conflict there. But generally, we're looking at six smaller structures where four larger structures were originally placed. What I've shown here in red is the view easement and conservation easement line to give you an idea that, yes, we are working on the same piece of ground and we are not going to be impacting that view easement any more than we would have with the four structures that were originally approved, just to bring that issue up. The road, we have made some changes in the road design. They occur in this first 500 feet of road, 400 feet of road, generally from Sawyer Road into approximately this location at the end of the curve. What I've shown on this drawing, the requested design change is shown here in the blue line. At this point, it matches in at the top end of the hill. The red line was the original design that was approved. I would like to point out that this green area in here is based on the actual ground survey. When we originally completed the design of the project, it was based on the survey done by aerial photography. In general, for the site, it was pretty good. In this particular area, there was one little knot of ledge that sticks up that made a substantial change in the existing topography in this location. So instead of having a 4.5-foot cut of rock in this area, we ended up with a 9-foot cut of rock. Obviously, that changes the aesthetics of the entrance as well as the cost and impact of the development in this area. We've redesigned the road within the new standards, new road design standards, to when you come off Sawyer Road, you'll come up a slight grade, you'll come over the crest of the hill, and then down into a section of road that is approximately 7.64%. This reduces the ledge cut to the original intended design of roughly 4 to 4.5 feet. So we feel with the new design, we achieve the same thing that the original design concept was to approve. Any questions on those?
Yes, I think Mr. Hunter commented on the roadway and said that the resulting grades are within those permitted by the ordinance, although when superimposed on sharp horizontal curves, they are less than ideal, and I just wondered how you translated that into a beneficial or helpful.
I guess I take a look at the
at the how the whole road system works. You have Sawyer Road, which is a stop and start point, so traffic at that point is not moving at a high rate of speed. This was 500 feet of straightaway going into the curves on this end, then obviously there would be more of a problem. That's essentially what you have on the lower end, is a straightaway coming into the sharp curves. They are within the ordinance, but they are obviously sharper than what may be desirable if you had the space to maneuver and get sight distances all the way along. So from that aspect coming into the project, I don't see the change in grades as a major problem. I think as traffic moves along in this direction, I think it will navigate both the curves and the grades reasonably well. And coming in the other direction, you're going uphill at a reasonable slope, 7.5%, which again has a tendency to reduce stopping distances and that type of thing. So from that aspect, that's a benefit to the way it's going in and out. Those are some bright sides to the negatives, I guess.
So it is a speed reducer too.
Yes, that's correct. I feel that from my aspect of a designer, that we are within the ordinance and we do have a road that will function adequately. From my aspects of a designer who's looking at the aesthetics, I would much rather drive into this road coming in with a 4-foot cut on the sides versus the 9-foot cut. I think that sets a better tone. Balancing off my engineering background, it's a better use of the landforms by going with the new design versus the old design.
Any other questions from the planning board members on that part?
I guess I'd just like to reemphasize what Mr. Hunter has pointed out, that he says that with what's being posed now, although it can be done, you're dealing with a vertical curve as well as a horizontal curve, and the conditions are less than ideal, to quote our town engineer. So the aesthetics may be there, but I think Bob Hunter has some reservations about what's being proposed now.
Mrs. Guthrie?
Madam Chairman, it's so difficult to envision these new changes, and I wondered if the planning board would consider a sidewalk.
I think that would ultimately be desirable for a number of different features that are being proposed.
I was going to ask, in connection with that, where we are procedurally. We have an item on our agenda that says amend approved plan. Where do you consider yourself as being? Are you in the pre-application stage, preliminary plan stage?
Well, I have no idea, Dan. I don't know. Do you start all over when you amend a plan? We amended a section of our first subdivision, Elizabeth Farms, around ledge outcropping right at the entrance, and went through it with an introductory meeting, and then went to a site walk with the board members, and then the following month came back and discussed it a little more, and it was approved. I don't think it followed the otherwise subdivision format of preliminary, pre-preliminary, etc., etc. Is there a
according to our new ordinance, Dan, which yes. I think we're applying now, it reads any change in approved final subdivision plan, including but not limited to lot line, street layout, and location of structures and improvements, must be reviewed and approved by the board, and a public hearing can be held. All amended plans must make specific reference to the original plan and its recording information. It must be signed by a majority of the board. I guess we felt that they were properly categorized in this fashion. Do you have a problem with that?
No, I haven't really thought about it until tonight. I guess I would have thought, and maybe this is where we're coming out anyway, that you have to use some judgment on the size of the amendment. And if somebody wants to move a road around within an existing approved plan, obviously they have to come back for approval. If someone wants to change condominium to houses and change a road to some significant extent, then they have to come back for approval, and I suppose somewhere in that continuum we have to decide whether we require a submission which would cover all of the same items that you would cover if you were in here today for the first time proposing six or seven homes in a road. I think we ought to talk about that and decide what we want, both for our benefit and for your benefit. I'm not happy just reacting and saying approved. Maybe I would be ultimately, but I think we ought to somehow get a handle on what we need for information.
Does the town planner or any other board members have any thoughts on that?
I'm sorry. Whenever an amendment is requested, we should go by the same score sheet as if there had been nothing that happened before. Then we can look back to the submissions. If they fulfill the conditions of the score sheet, 50%, okay. But we should look at all the sequence. And if the original submission on drainage was fine, good, we check that one on. But we should consciously go through each one of the points.
Any other comments on that? Would you like to reassess?
I think the general principle is exactly what we ought to be doing. It may be that we can decide in 2 minutes that we have all we need, but I suppose we have to run through it.
This could be quite fast.
Do I understand board members to say that they feel more comfortable with a pre-application?
At this point, you mean?
Yes.
That's what I've heard. And as an individual board member, there are submissions, as Jack was indicating, that are not with us, such as stormwater. I mean, what happened to stormwater? No change, then that's fine, but there has to be a representation of that. I think Marion's comment and suggestion is an excellent one, that maybe one of the first things that we need to do is go out and see that area, to tramp on the road, to look at where this ledge outcropping is, to get a feel ourselves for the significance of a change. To stand there and look at where the multiplex units were going to be, or the large units were going to be, and where the lots are now being proposed, and how that affects the land trust area, and how that affects the road layout. That might help in how far we have to go in the process of a revised application as well. That information has been submitted, and presumably a lot of it is still applicable. We're not doing a major, or the applicant isn't doing a major change. I think it's moving in the right direction, less density for the site. So maybe we need to go out and tramp the site, look at it, look at what's being proposed, and then work with him to determine what has to be submitted in terms of the ordinance, the individual pieces.
Typically, we don't have a site plan until we have a completed application. Is that right?
That's correct.
Are you suggesting, Dick, that we have the site walk before we determine whether we have a complete application?
Sure. Well, we have an approved subdivision, and an applicant wants to make some changes to that. We went through a long process before, and I think we would have a better feel for how complete the application is if we were to go out and walk it.
I think that's probably a meritorious path to proceed on. There are a couple of questions I guess we'd like to, while you're here, and before we go on a site walk, just touch upon. One of them is that, I applaud your willingness and indication that you want to improve the aesthetics of the area. But I'm a little concerned about and I love spaghetti, but I look on those lots as being fairly spaghetti-shaped in design, and I wonder about your thinking, how that fits in with the rest of the the rest of your development?
Well, there was quite a number of different lot designs that finally ended up being this one, and these six new lots and the three abut lots just to the west of it really ended up being larger than any of the other lots, simply because we had so many different stopping points across the field. We have a view easement, we had a conservation easement line, we had, in order to meet the required density, the required lot size, we had lots over here, these three, that took a little corner in here, went over to there, and then had to step out and back over into the middle of this somewhere. And we said, what's the difference whether they're 2 acres or three acres to anybody, really? Only this part is usable because that's the only area that's not already committed to the easement, either by conservation or by view. Why don't we just take at least one point that's a straight line somewhere, so that generally people living there can say, here's about where my property is. Other than that, the new ordinance requires 200 feet of road frontage versus the old ordinance, which required 200 feet at the house width. So they sort of hourglass these a little bit in order to get that straight, that one non-spaghetti function of the whole subdivision.
Do you still have one lot which is separated by the street?
Separated by the street, no. No.
I'm not sure
we had one time drawn and submitted a 7-lot subdivision of the 40-some-odd acres, which were 6 across this side of the road and 1 over here. And that just seemed to be squeezing it too much. That lot had too much effect on Sawyer Road and vice versa, and on our existing lot number 13 here. It just was too tight, so we just dropped it.
Yeah. Madam Chairman, I think Mr. Box is referring to the fact that not everybody has a revised set of plans. We have the original sketch plan sort of submission. I'm not, at least my packet, I know I don't have a copy of the revised plans that take over from 7 down to 6 lots.
Come to my rescue, Jane.
I'm sure how everybody else prepared.
Yes. Okay, we were one, for some reason we were one shot.
I wonder whether that is something that we ought to do when wait till we've seen it and then all have a copy of the latest plan.
Everybody has a problem. What? Let's look at a calendar.
That's one.
Would Saturday, the 6th of February, be a dandy day for you?
Dandy. Took the words right out of my mouth. That's exactly the day I'd like to meet.
All the board members, any objection to that? And
morning.
Morning. Would you like to say what? 9 o'clock?
9 o'clock.
9 o'clock it is on February 6th for a site walk. And if you could indicate the site distances for us, which I guess were a little bit, and maybe a layout of where the houses are going to
do a little surveying in the meantime.
Great.
Perhaps also just as long as we're going out there, we can set aside enough time to also look at the buildable acreage issue that I submitted last
right.
two times.
That would be good to include that in our walk.
Okay.
And we'll do that. Mr. Butler, did you have another
question? I wanted to raise that issue.
Fine.
What is the next submittal date? Was that after
that would
this?
That 18 days before.
January 29th.
Is the meeting.
January 29th is the submittal date for the February meeting, which is on February 16th. It's early in February.
So the next time I'll get back here is in March, in other words, or build condos. Just in other considerations as to, it doesn't make any difference to me. I will come back in March because I don't want to build condominiums. But if I had to go through the whole process all over again to make an amendment that, particularly if its only effect was aesthetic, it might be discouraging to a developer to go through that all again to improve his plan based on information they may find along the way.
But I would hope you wouldn't object to putting on drainage and some basic things that might be altered because
not at all.
Road and also I think
I wouldn't have minded doing it for this meeting either.
I think also it might be helpful if you put in writing that change in road from the, just to help speed things along, that change in road, it meets with the approval of the DEP and maybe
yeah.
Central Maine Power, since they were both involved in the
right.
previous plan. You might want to get that in writing from each of those parties
yeah.
for us for your next package.
I saw in the file somewhere what I recall as a DEP approval of the amendment with respect to your subsurface disposal system. Have they approved this change too?
Tom and I were just talking about this just before we started this portion of the meeting, and frankly, we're not clear. They've approved the plan. The plan that was submitted for this plan, which has the subdivision, has the new disposal area and the revised road plan on it, but we're not sure whether in fact they took note to all those changes or just the sewer.
When you made your application to them, did you apply for
the whole shebang
to 6 or 7 lots instead of the condominium building?
Yeah, we gave them the whole outline.
Because in our defense, you would have to go through on the DEP level everything from scratch on an amendment to a plan. Now, it may be that you can say already answered an original submission that we're suggesting,
mm-hmm.
But you wouldn't get, in theory, any better deal or shorter deal from the DEP than we're talking about here.
Yeah, no, I'm not criticizing. I think it's an excellent point that you brought up, that ought to be, this is a new ordinance now, and it's a good time to lay down new rules or more clear rules. The last time, I said I didn't know where I stand, because the last time I came for an amendment to a subdivision, it was as I described. First we did this, that, and then we got approval. I think that it's better for everybody to know what they're confronted with, or will be confronted with right at the beginning. And that, I think that what you suggested is good, that we go through the same checklist, and as Mr. Orr pointed out, that may be something we can go through rather quickly, not as long, lengthy, and as in-depth as we just did 6 months ago with the major portion of the subdivision. But that's a good format, is to go through that 10...
You understood that's your burden. To supply us with material that supports your application for an amended subdivision, and it may be that we're going to be flexible, and maybe that you can simply say all this information is the same and not give us anything more. I'm not saying you have to repackage it, but I do think you've got to supply us with some documents
yeah.
that supports it to be included application.
I said your point's well taken. I don't mean to sound more critical than I am. Sorry. see you on February 6th.
We will see you on February 6th, and thank you very much. February 26th will be when that. If you are returning in March, the secretary reminds us that February 26th is your deadline.
Thank you.
Madam Chairman, a key piece of these changes is contained in the legal document dated December 28th from it's Thompson, Nabo, Ashley, and Bull Law Firm. And my only question is, has the town attorney looked at that? Because there was no letter indicating that in our packets.
Madam Chairman, the town attorney has indeed looked at the options, found it to be sufficient.
Good.
As long as this process goes rather quickly, it'll be sufficient.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. We might take a 5-minute recess now. Good camp. The next.
If I got a copy of that,
The next item of business is F.S. Plummer on Eastfield Road coming in for a resource protection zone change under section 19-4-9, parentheses B, and a wetlands alteration, section 19-3-9. I believe that we have a representative of F.S. Plummer, if not he himself.
I don't know, would you like just like have me begin? Or
if you could describe why you want a resource protection zone change and what you have done to submit.
And why don't I just review a little bit, if that's all right. Tonight with me is Peggy McGee from the law firm of Perkins, Thompson, Hinckley, and Ketty of Portland. I'm Mark Plummer. I'm the owner of the F.S. Plummer Company. I'm here tonight representing the F.S. Plummer Company and also Fred Plummer. We made an initial presentation to this board back on October 20th. At that time, our initial presentation was for a rezoning request from an RP zone back to an RA zone at some lots we own in a subdivision called Eastfields. We indicated at that time we would submit an alteration for wetlands in the future. In our letter of December 30th to you, Mrs. Rand, we requested that the wetlands be removed from property we own in Eastfields, and in the alternative, an alteration to wetlands permit be issued if we could not get the removed. In addition, on October 20th, we received a memo from Mr. Buck on items that were missing from our initial rezoning request. Today we have submitted two packages.